So two people's name I had suggested for this particular class. So we'll study about the different factors. I think I should go with the discussion about the magnetizing current of the transformer like previously, also of the induction motor, which we saw previously. Let me open a open the white board, start the new board, okay. Present window. Set new board. It. So these people, two people I had mentioned, are they present? Huh? So what about the flip class? Shall I start with my class then? Okay, I'll start now. Technical problem. Whiteboard, can you see?
No,
Can you see
sir.
the whiteboard? Okay, okay,
No,
wait,
sir.
wait, wait. I'm just trying it first. Okay, no problem. Yeah, I came to you cannot see. So, wait, something has to happen. Why is it typical? Google Chrome has changed this a bit. Now they have so much many options. So I'll just Now are you able to see the board?
Yes, sir.
Okay. Mine was muted.
Yes, sir.
So today we will study the discussion of the no load current of a three-phase induction motor. So how do we set up the no load current of the induction motor? So so in today's class we'll be studying to study the no load current of induction motor. So how do we go about the no load current? What do you mean by the no load current of the induction motor? Can anyone tell what is no load current? So no load current is the current when there is no load connected on the induction motor side. Suppose if you are having an induction motor design on the secondary, there is no load connected, that would mean no load current. So basically the no load current of induction motor is made up of two components. No load current of induction motor is made up of two components. So what are those two components? So the first component of which the no load current is made up of is called the magnetizing component of induction motor. So the number one component would be called as magnetizing component of induction motor. And the second component that is made up of induction motor is the loss component of no load current. So this is loss component of no load current. So if your no load current of induction motor is given as I naught, okay, or some books will write it as I no load. This is called I magnetization would be written as IM, and this is loss component would be given as IL. So basically the relationship between your induction motor magnetization component and your loss component and your no load current is this is a phasor sum. The no load current is a phasor sum of your magnetization current and your loss component current. So we can also write the no load current of the induction motor, the no load current of induction motor, no load current of induction motor is a phasor sum of magnetization current IM and IL. So basically what happens is that your magnetization current, that is your magnetization current IM is 90 degrees out of phase with the voltage. IM is 90 degrees out of phase with the supply phase with the voltage. That would be the supply voltage with the voltage. And IL is in phase with voltage, in phase with voltage. So basically this is the thing. So now if we look to go for suppose we are looking to draw a phasor diagram. So the phasor diagram would look like this. So this is your IM, that is 90 degree apart from the base voltage. This is your voltage, okay, and this is your in phase with the voltage. इन फेज विद द वोल्टेज सेम लाइन दैट इज योर IL. तो IL एंड नाउ यू विल बी हैविंग योर आई नॉट इज समवेयर हियर. आई नॉट, सो आई नॉट इज अ वेक्टर, इज अ फेजर सम ऑफ दीज टू क्वांटिटीज. सो यू कैन राइट इन द एंड दिस इज द एंगल आई नॉट. सो वॉट यू कैन राइट इज दैट योर नो लोड करेंट आई नॉट इन टर्म्स ऑफ योर रेक्टेंगुलर फॉर्म यू कैन राइट इट एज is and the magnitude of it is Im square plus IL square, where this is the magnetization current and this is the no load current. And similarly from here also, if you want to calculate the power factor, so power cos phi would be based by hypotenuse. So here, see, if this is a right angle triangle, cos phi naught would be IL by I naught. So no load power factor, that you can write no load power factor, you can write that is equal to cos phi naught, that is nothing but as tell me I1 by I naught, or phi naught would be equal to cos inverse of I1 by I naught. So this is cos inverse of okay. So now the magnetizing current. So what it affects and what are the factors that it depends upon? So it basically helps in the flux produced by the stator winding passes through the following parts. So the magnetizing current IM, so it is helpful in establishing the flux through the stator, and flux produced by stator winding passes through. So like in the stator winding, you have, see, an induction motor is there. First, you in an induction motor, like if you have to understand induction motor, your supply is there, okay, three phase supply R, Y, B, okay. This supply is fed to the stator winding, okay. Stator winding is within the stator, okay. So then after the stator winding, there is the stator, it's within the stator over here. Stator, you can see over here. Then after the stator, you have the rotor, but there between the stator and the rotor, see this, if I can make this as a cylindrical cross section, something like this, okay. Like imagine like this. So this is a hollow sphere. Inside this, we have this shaft, okay. We insert this shaft. Here we have a rotor. If you will go through the induction motor, this is the shaft coming out. There is no electrical connection between the stator and the rotor. So there is an air gap. So what we have is that it passes through the air gap. It passes through the stator. We have some teeth, like the laminations are there. So like this, we have teeth on stator. We have teeth on rotor. So these are, we have a core on stator. We have a core on rotor. So this induction machine passes through the number one thing, which would be your number one, it passes through the air gap, okay. Number two, we can write that it passes through the stator teeth. It passes through the stator teeth. And number third thing would be, it also passes through the rotor teeth, your rotor teeth. Number four, it goes through your stator core. So stator core. Number five, it goes through the rotor core. So these are the different sections through which it passes. So these are the sections that I have shown you through which it passes. Again, Now, see what happens is that, like in the last class, I derived a formula for magnetization current, 0.427, okay, PAT, 0.427 PAT 60 KWSTA. So I directly applied, but today I'll explain you how it came. So basically, what happens is that your MMF that is being developed, it is developed, it is getting developed not exactly at, if you can see here, the MMF that you are developing is due to the no load current, and this no load current is not exactly with the sync with the 0 degree axis, it's not at a 0 degree axis. So this no load current over here, you can see, is at around, you can say safely, you can say it's around how much? It's around 30 degrees from the polar axis, or you can say it is at a 60 degree from interpolar axis. So in this case, which I can say to you that it is like, okay, we'll make this little zoom it. Okay, so you have seen over here. So next page, what I'm trying to explain you is there is like, this is 100%. Okay, so now MMF at 60 degree from interpolar axis. So the MMF that we develop is either at MMF that we develop is either at 60 degrees from interpolar axis, okay, or 30 degrees from pole axis, okay. So the thing is that when the MMF which you are developing, MMF that the symbol is like this, is nothing but as number of turns into current, okay. We are also writing it in other terms. If the number of turns is represented by T and current by A, so we write it as ampere turns. So MMF is written number of turns into turn, where your ampere is given by current and number of turns, that is your this T, is given by N. So that is your MMF basically. Now MMF at 60 degrees, like MMF at 60 degrees, that is ampere turns at 60 degrees would read like, ampere turns normally at 60 degree, because your current, if you see that your current, the waveform of the current, alternating current, is sinusoidal in nature. So at 60 degrees, it cannot be any 60 degrees. It has to be sine 60 degree, okay? Sine 60. If you are taking voltage with the cosine and then sine, this is the sine 60 degrees. Wherein sine 60 degrees, you are writing at root 3 by 2. We have the value. And this becomes root 3 by 2 ampere turns. Okay. And now you know that you are basically, if you have to go for the ampere turns, your MMF, this MMF you can express in terms of flux also. Because you know that from the very beginning, I have taught you, your magnetic flux density, this B, is equal to flux by area, okay. And you have a relationship between your flux and MMF, okay. So how is flux related to MMF? Can anyone tell me here? Yeah, flux into flux divided by reluctance will give you MMF, okay. Or you can get this like here, flux by into permeance was your nothing but as MMF. So similarly to here, if we manipulate these, please go look back into your previous classes which I have taken. You will establish the MMF in terms of your flux, and you will, when you write this in terms of flux, MMF in terms of flux, so you can write flux by other quantities, and flux you can establish in terms of other factors. So when you are doing that manipulation, you will land up ampere turns instead of writing. This is your homework part. I want, this is the part of homework I want all of you to do, because every time I have done in my class, so this part, this equation straight away I will write. I want you people to do go for this. So this ampere turns I will replace by 2.71 I phase T phase, okay, KWS, and this is directly I'm doing, and number of poles. So I want you, how did I express this ampere turns in terms of this? Okay, this is your homework. Hint I have given you. I can replace it in terms of flux. Flux I can express in other terms like this. So these parts tomorrow I'll be asking tomorrow in the early morning session. And those people whom I have given already the what you call is the flip class, please raise your hands. Please flip class. Please tell me who are those people. Otherwise, I can find it out from my this thing
Sir,
drive.
me,
Kiran, you are you prepared today? Kiran,
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Sai Kiran, sir. Yes, sir. Prepare, sir.
Sai Kiran, and one more person I had asked to prepare. Who's that? Two people I had asked, na? What is the second person? Please tell me the name. Okay. So Sai Kiran, 5 minutes or 5-10 minutes more, I'll be finishing off with this. So once you express this ampere turns at 60, so you get around, so you get around your magnetization current, you will get around 0.427. This is okay. A. So this was around 2.7. Okay, so basically what I do is that here P A T 60 divided by K W S T S. If I reduce this bit to 50 over here, so we are not getting much. So you are able to see, right? 0.427 P A T 60. So here what I do is that I put this current, my I phase here. So my current I phase, I can write, how can I write this I phase? I can write it terms of AT60 into 2P divided by 2.7 into root 3 into T phase KWS. So this current I can substitute like this part of the current over here, and I get at this particular expression. So now the total magnetizing MMF per pole for B60 is equal to, so total magnetizing MMF would be equal to MMF of the air gap plus the MMF that I am developing, and this would be equal to your 8,000. Okay, so the total MMF for the air, so the total magnetizing MMF we can write, total magnetizing MMF. Now this for in terms of your magnet, for in terms of your, this is BG60, in terms of your magnet flux, in terms of your magnetizing flux density. So this total magnetic MMF would be around, see, it is given as 80,000. So this is the reason for this 80,000 from where. So this comes around, you can say this is around. So the total magnetizing MMF, that is ATGA, happens to be around 80,000, and BG60 into IGKG. So that is the gap contraction factor. This is the current, and this is the magnetizing MMF, and this again you see root 3 by 2. So this is 60 degrees from the interpolar axis. So whatever the normal air gap is there, air gap, into sine of 60 degrees. So sine of 60 degrees is around root 3 by 2, and root 3 by 2, if you add up to this, so it will become around, this ampere current would become around, what happened? So, yeah, this would be equal to 1.36 BeV. So this is the total current. Now, you have certain things like MMF per meter length of stator teeth, depth length of stator teeth. So the MMF required for the stator teeth, see, that is an advanced thing that I'm giving you, but numericals normally. So MMF required for stator, MMF required for stator teeth. Okay, this would be around your ATS, and this is around ATS plus your DSS. So where this ATS is what? ATS is basically nothing but MMF per meter length of stator teeth. So this is MMF per meter length of stator teeth. So and what is the other quantity over there? What is this quantity? What is DSS? So this is the depth of the rotor slot, or is also equal to the depth of the rotor teeth, sorry, stator teeth. So this is the depth of the stator teeth. So depth of stator teeth. Similarly, same thing, we will have MMF required for stator teeth. So we also have the MMF required for rotor teeth. So this is the one concept. The other thing is that we require MMF for rotor teeth. Again, the MMF required for rotor teeth will depend upon the dimensions. And this is like in that case, we wrote ATS, this ATR. And here it would be ATR into DSR. ATR into, there also it is DSR. By mistake, I have written plus or a, it's multiplication. It's a area, okay? MMF is basically established for the area. So the MMF for rotor teeth would be like, this is the depth of the rotor slot. And depth, this is again the depth of the rotor slot. Depth of rotor slot, or we can write teeth, okay, teeth. And this particular thing is again the mm length of the rotor teeth, or MMF per meter length of rotor teeth. So we can write MMF per meter, this is per meter length of a rotor teeth. So now this we have seen the MMF, and what are the other factors, like apart from this, what are the other factors? See, again, we, after the rotor teeth is there, we have to also incorporate the different cores. So we have to go, because basically the core has to saturate or not saturate, core has to get some magnetization, then only there would be a relative motion between the stator and the rotor, because the core has to be. So for MMF, okay, MMF for stator core would be ATCS into ICS, okay, where, see, now we have MMF for stator core. So what is this stator core MMF? So this MMF for stator core that we require would be given in terms of, see, ATCS, wherein ATCS is AT, small ATCS into, we can write into ICS, where your ICS is the length of flux path in stator core. So this is your ICS, is length of stator, length of flux path in stator port. This is the length of flux path in stator core. So this is the length of the stator flux path in the stator core. Whereas your this ACS, what is this? This is the, again you can write, this is nothing but the MMF per meter length of stator core. So whenever this is coming, MMF per meter length of stator core. So this is what exactly you mean, MMF of stator core. Similarly, you can write MMF for rotor core. So you can write ATR, wherein you can write, this is for, this was for this. You can write for here, MMF for rotor core, which would be A. MMF for rotor core, you can write in terms of AT CR instead of S, and that would be AT CR into IR. Okay, or ICR, it was, you can write ICS, you can write ICR, and the same things will be there. But please pay attention. So, length of flux path through stator core. So, this length of flux path in the above C, length of flux path, if you have to write, length of flux path that is in stator core, that is your ICS. How do you establish the length? Prior to going to the length, let's get some certain things. Let's understand. So let me draw a circle. So I'm having a circle. Okay. So this is the circle. Okay, here. Let this be here. Okay. Another circle let me draw. Okay. So one more. Okay, but it's becoming a little opaque. We don't want it. Okay. What happened? See, okay. This is the circle. Forget about that other part, other one. So, how many are coming here? I'll take it to the next slide and I'll explain you. Okay, so here we have, so let me take one circle just. Okay, only one. Okay, and over this circle I have, I'll be drawing you. So imagine this is a circle of cross section. Now you have to, like, your teeth are there. So sorry, I'm bad at drawing, but yeah. So this is exactly the cross-sectional view it will look like.
So what I mean is here, you can see the top of this section and the bottom of this section. So here, so this will give you the DCR value. That is your diameter of the rotor core and stator core DSR value. And now for the dia of the stator, rotor would be inside. This is the rotor like, and the outside body, this is the rotor core. At the outside body is the stator teeth. These are the stator teeth. And basically this from this part to this part, so this will give you DCR, that is the rotor core dia, okay. And similarly down there, DCR down there, you can see, and from here to, from the top of this to the bottom of this, this entire diameter is there. So this is the DR value, and this is the rotor core, basically the core, rotor core. Here we have not drawn another circle. If I draw another circle like this, so this would be another circle like this, means it would be the stator core. So here it would be the stator core. Now what I want to be able to understand is the your length of the flux path through stator core. So if we have to look at the length of the flux path, so if I have to draw length of flux path, that is ICS through stator core, would be given by 1/3 of the pole pitch at mean diameter. So this is given at 1/3 of the pole pitch, that is pole pitch is pi d by p, of the 1/3 into pole pitch at mean diameter. So pole pitch at mean diameter. So this pole pitch at mean diameter, how do we give? So this pole pitch at mean diameter, pi d by p, it is basically, pole pitch is what? Pole pitch is pi d by p. So mean diameter. So d ka mean you have to get. So in order to get the mean of the d, so you will require your the d value, you require the value of the your DSS, okay, that is your stator diameter. Then you have to require the rotor diameter. So here if you see the stator diameter, so the stator diameter as far as and the rotor diameter is concerned, so you have here also, you have a DSR here, another DSR you will be having down there, okay. So here and here also you have a DSR, okay. So you can have this DCR. So this is your DCR value. So this DCR, and here also you got one DCR, okay. So basically you have that means how many DCR values you are having, tell me. So you can write down this DCR is basically what you saw. This is the dia of the for the rotor, and DSR is for the dia of the stator. So you can write it in terms of formula. You can write in terms of pi d by 1/3 of the pole pitch at the mean diameter. This can be written as 1/3 into the pi. Now d you have to express, p will also remain. So d mean you have to take of d. So when you are taking the mean, the this diameter, no mean, you don't require any mean, you will write d. And drs, you will write, what is it called? D or dr, whatever it is. Some books write it d, so we'll keep it as d. And you'll have 2 times d, that is dcs or dcs, because we are having dcs. Here also we are having DCS, and here also we were having DCS, plus you will write your sorry, DSS, that is the stator part. This is DCR, na? So some books write it like this, DCS. Instead of TCR, they will write DSS, okay? Plus, you have your DSR, DCS. So this DSR, you can write also DCS. So this is the formula for the stator code. So we can write safely. Yeah. So in the next class, I'll like to present the other factors. Now, because the time is very limited, I want, yes, Saikiran. Saikiran?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Can you present your this thing?
Yes, sir.
Then in the next class, I'll continue with it. So because flip class is also very important. Go ahead and present.
Okay, sir.
I'll stop presenting. Yeah, present your thing and you'll wind up the class here.
Is it visible?
Yeah.
So today I'm going to explain about the effects of air gap on the performance of an induction motor. So before I start with this, I'll be explaining about the construction features of the induction motor. I mean the construction overview of the induction motor. It basically has two major parts, the stator and the rotor. The stator is a stationary part and the rotor is the rotating part. And all the wires are placed 120 degrees apart, 120 degrees electrical apart, and what we can observe is we know that the stator, in the stator, the electric energy is converted into the magnetic energy. The magnetic energy travels to the air gap of the motor. So here we can see the air gap. The air gap, this increases the reluctance of the magnetic circuit. So we can see we can say the air gap, it actually decides. It actually affects on the performance of the induction motor. So there are various factors where the induction motor, the performance varies. So one of which is the magnetizing current and the power factor. So here the magnetizing current mostly depends upon the specific magnetic loading and the air gap length of the machine. So as the air gap length increases, the reluctance path of the magnetic flux also increases. So as the reluctance increases, the magnetic flux also, as the air gap length increases, the reluctance also increases. So, hello.
Yeah. Carry on. Yes, sir, I'm hearing.
And so here we can see. Here we can see how the air gap length between there's a difference. There's a difference in the smaller air gap and the larger air gap. So we can observe one thing: the phi 1, these angles vary. Like for a smaller air gap length, this angle between the applied voltage and the stator current is more for the larger air gap, and for the smaller air gap length, that's small, the air gap length.
So yeah, and due to this, the power factor also becomes low. So the X factor is the overload capacity. The overload capacity is nothing but the maximum level of current or voltage or power that a device can withstand before it is damaged. We can also say like its ability to respond to sudden surges in load current without allowing the output voltage level to decrease. So the leakage flux is reduced with the increase in air gap length. The flux produced in the stator winding, it's almost fully coupled, and rotor winding of the air gap is more. So as the air gap length is more, the overload capacity of the motor increases. So as the leakage reactance increases, the overload capacity also increases. Next one is cooling. So it's obvious, right? If we have more space, means there'll be more cooling, like more air can enter. So here we can see if large air gap length is there, the cooling is also better, and the losses also takes place. And the losses also they somehow take place, but the heat transferred is easily, the heat is easily transferred if the motor has a larger air gap.
Okay, and, nice, nice presentation. So I'd like you to wind it up because it's already before the next class. So please, can you wind it up?
Yes, sir. Like two more points only, sir.
Yeah. Please, yeah. Because there is next class at 2:20, yes, right?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, wind it
next
up.
Is the noise. If the leakage flux gets reduced with the air gap length, the less noise is reduced. So more air gap length means you have less noise. Next is the tooth pulsation losses. Tooth pulsation losses.
Plus.
Yes, sir.
No. Yeah, continue.
So for every rotating machine with a stator slot has a energy loss caused by the pulsation of magnetic flux density distribution in the air gap. So air in the air gap. So this loss is known as the tooth pulsation losses. And
so now you can give your attendance, and you can leave the meeting, rest of all. So please give the attendance because you have to do it. Yeah, you continue.
Yes, sir. And so as tooth pulsation losses reduced, it is reduced for increase in air gap length. Next, the last one is the unbalanced magnetic pull. The unequal magnetic pull. So if there are unequal magnetic pulls unequal magnetic pulls are there, means the magnetic pull acts in the direction of the shortest air gap. So we can see in this diagram, the place where there is the shorter air gap, the magnetic pull is attracted towards that point. And the motor with the smaller air gap length draws less magnetizing current, and the power factor of the motor is better than motor having larger air gap length. So it should be having a lesser air gap length to draw minimum current. So you might be wondering, like, what might be the minimum optimum air gap length then? So just to find out that, there's an empirical formula. Yeah, Ig equals to 0.2 plus 2 into root 2 into L into D, where L is the stator core length and D is the diameter of the stator core. That's all, sir.
Okay. Please put your attendance, and you can also leave. So I'll stop recording. 1 minute.
Okay, sir.